Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Neil Haley Show. You can check me out on Twitter at TuttleTutor, neilhaley.com, all those exciting places, and we continue to have amazing interviews. I like a studio, get to network, have great conversations, great stories. Check me out, follow me, like it, do all those different things. And I have my co-host, Coach Karen Hall, WPL Hall of Famer, UNLV Running Web, ESPN analyst, City League Hall of Fame, first woman, Connie Hawkins League, all those different things. Coach, thanks for coming by, and I look forward to our guest.
No, always a pleasure. We have a good time here. Mm-hmm. So we want to keep our good time moving with Aaron Gibson, who is the executive director of the YMCA, the Thelma Lovett.
Yes.
YMCA in the Hill District. So, Aaron, welcome to our show.
Thank you for having me.
Good. Well, just relax and have a good time here with us.
Okay.
We want to get to know you and how you became an executive director. But first, we want to take us back to the world of sports with you.
Okay. So, I am a Larmer Avenue resident.
Okay.
Born and raised there. And I went to Razenstein School, which is no longer there.
Right.
And then I went to West Nile School, played football there, started since I was in 10th grade.
Okay.
Never got off the field because I played various positions. You know, was pretty good. That Coach Leroy Diller was my defensive coach.
Okay.
Come to love him.
Yeah.
He's like a father figure to me because as I was raised, my grandmother raised me since the time I was 10 years old. But Coach Dale, when I met Coach Dale, he have helped change my life, you know, and got me to focus on, you know, eating right.
Right.
Weightlifting,
yep.
Staying disciplined and focused. And, you know, and then once I got out of high school, I kind of went a different path in my life, you know, and which wasn't the right path. You know, I began to sell drugs. You know, I became a young father at the age of 22. Was selling drugs in the Larmer Avenue area. You know, just ran into, you know, problems at that time. Anytime you're, you know, selling drugs or anything else like that, it's just not good, you know.
Right.
And then you're, you know, even though you're thinking about the cars, the money, and the women, but there's always other issues to come with that. You know, get, you know, I wouldn't call it now. Back then I would call it being harassed by the police.
Right.
But if you're doing illegal things, of course you're going to get harassed,
right.
You know, and get pulled over and all that.
Exactly.
So those are the things I went through in my life as a young, you know, 20-something year old. And then I got involved with the YMCA. One of the outreach workers from the Homewood YMCA reached out to me. You know, he must have seen some type of leadership in me.
Nice.
And he said, hey, I want you to be a part of this program that we're starting at the downtown YMCA, which was located at the Boulevard of the Outlets before Point Park had bought it out. And he got maybe about 10 or 12 of us from different communities. Now, during the 90s, the gangs was really bad here in Pittsburgh. Really bad here. You know, Larmer Avenue was called Larmer Avenue Wilkinsburg. Homewood was the Homewood Crips, Garfield, the Bloods, East Hills, the Bloods, Lincoln Avenue. You know, Lincoln Avenue was the Crips. So there was these different folks from these different communities. And they set us down, a gentleman named Jim Cimino, which today I call him my surrogate father, a little short Italian white guy.
Okay.
You know, he taught us how to, he got us together to talk about, he wanted to teach us how to build computers and then start our own business.
Oh, great.
So now you're talking about a group of individuals who, if they weren't gang related, they may have sold drugs or gang affiliated. He got 12 of us in this room.
Wow.
And taught us how to build computers.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not, you know, now everything's proprietary. But back then it was motherboard, CPU, the RAM, the sound card, the video card. He got us all to learn how to build the computer.
Mm-hmm.
Then we had to load on DOS, which is this operating system.
Yeah.
And then we loaded on Windows. At that time it was 3.0. So that tells you how long ago that was. And he taught us how to do this and taught us how to come together. You know, and that these different communities that was once close and then during the 90s, you know, went into his different directions and start fighting and killing each other. He got us all together as a group to teach us how to build computers. And we started our own business. It was called Eminon Computer Systems. Eminon spelled backwards is no name. No name for a bunch of individuals from these different communities coming together to learn how to build computers.
So he brought you all together. But it wasn't as if you just, did you just go, great, this sounds good, I'm going to leave this behind, I'm going to go over here. Where were you in your mind to not resist that pull you in a different direction?
Well, that's a great question. Yeah. Great question. So while all this is going on, right, I'm accustomed to making all this money.
Sure.
Right. But I got focused on building these computers because it was just something about those computers, something about, you know, building your, working with these individuals to build up your business. But at the same time, I was a young father. Mm-hmm. And I still had to take care of my kids.
Yeah.
And this wasn't bringing in any money to me. So I was still hustling on the side.
Okay.
But also, at the same time, I don't know, trying to change my life.
Okay.
During that process, I got convicted for selling drugs.
Okay.
I got caught up.
Okay.
You know, and so I had to go pay the piper.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
At that time during the 90s, that's when they started the minimum mandatory. So it was my first time ever in trouble.
Okay.
Right.
You know, selling drugs or anything. That was my first time ever in trouble. Because my grandmother always kept me on the right path.
Yeah.
And then going through school with Coach Dillard kept me on the right path.
Right.
Then when it was time to get out on my own, I went astray.
Right.
But what had happened was I got caught up. It was time to pay the piper. So I had to do a minimum of 3 to 6 years.
Wow.
Okay. So went down the county after they convicted me. And the judge didn't want to send me to, he didn't really want to send me to jail because he knew what I was already doing. Joe Camino went to court with me and spoke on my behalf.
Sure.
But the judge said, hey, it's out of my hands. Because the minimum mandatory, they took it out of the judge's hand.
Right.
So what I had to do, I had to go. So I went through the system. I got up to Camp Hill, was up Camp Hill. Mm-hmm. Went through all that. Then I went to Waynesburg jail, which was a small, it's a very small, you know, I wouldn't call it a small retention, I call it like a retention center or something.
Okay.
You know. And so then they end up sending me to Laurel Highlands. Now, Laurel Highlands was once a state hospital.
Okay.
But during the 90s, when Ridge was the governor, they closed down a lot of state hospitals.
Mm-hmm.
So they end up making some of these state hospitals into prisons because they was building more prisons.
Yep.
Now with these all minimum mandatories, they're building more prisons. And so what happened was someone from there, a young lady I met, one of the counselors, and, you know, something she just took on and said, hey, why are you in here?
Right.
You know, and I said, because I sold drugs. And I told her, she said, well, there's an opportunity for you to go to boot camp. Instead of you doing a minimum of 3 years with the possibility of doing 40 years, you can do just do a year in jail, year upstate, and then in 6 months, you can go home. I said, in boot camp? Sir, yes, sir.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Got in the boot camp. I went up there. I was weighing maybe about 215, 220 for my height and frame. That's a lot of weight. When I graduated out of high school, I was 165 pounds.
Wow.
Went through boot camp, a Kuhana boot camp, and, you know, I end up becoming, I broke records up there for the exercises up there. I was the top of the class. So when you graduate out of boot camp, so in 6 months I was able to, you know, break records in PT, never got any trouble, was the top, it was a top candidate or I won some, I can't remember what it was actually because it's been a little over 20 years ago, but I was the top candidate and got this reward. And guess who was there to pick me up?
Coach Dillard.
No, it wasn't Coach Dillard.
Oh.
I have another story with Coach Dillard.
Okay.
It was Jim Cimino.
Mm.
Jim Cimino came and picked me up from boot camp, brought me back to the YMCA. The YMCA at that time, the president at that time, the CEO was Julius Jones.
Remember that name.
Julius Jones is an African American man from the deep south.
Mm-hmm.
Big hands, big feet, 6'6". Mm-hmm. Sits down at the desk and says, I sit down, I'm like, because you went to jail, don't make you tough.
Right.
And I'm saying, because he still has a presence. Right. And he said, Aaron, what you want to do with your life? Mm-hmm. In his James Earl Jones voice.
Yes.
And I said, sir, I want to, you know, lead or go into the right direction in my life.
Yes.
He said, we're going to give you an opportunity.
Okay.
And so they started me working at the YMCA. It started at the Center Avenue YMCA. Mm. Went there to go, you know, just to see how things was running there. got accustomed to how to run operations.
Okay.
Right.
Then they sent me to the Hazelwood YMCA,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
which when I got there, there was a 78-year-old cook and a 74-year-old bus driver. And I had 10 kids in the program.
Oh, wow.
And they said, run this facility.
Oh, my. Yeah.
So everything I've learned from boot camp, everything I've learned from school, I've took everything I learned from computers. So I cleaned up the place.
Mm.
Cleaned it up. Put a computer lab in there.
Mm.
Got another bus. You know, started talking to the parents. Mm. Cleaned up the place. Went from 10 kids to 60 kids.
Mm.
Took a deficit branch and turned it around to be a surplus branch.
Mm. Wow.
Then they said, hey, we want you back over there to Center Avenue, but this time you're going to be the executive director there.
Oh, wow.
I said, huh?
Mm.
I said, okay. Went over to Center Avenue. Now, I went in there with the carrot and a stick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because over at the Center Avenue YMCA, we have men that reside there. We have 77 men.
Mm-hmm.
We have 77 rooms, and we was always about 90% occupancy.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Well, when you're in a facility like that, oh, man. And a lot of those guys was once incarcerated, can't stay with their parents or their kids' mom because mm-hmm. if they live in public housing, you have a felony on your jacket,
right.
you can't live in public
right.
housing. So that's the only place you have to stay or one of the places you have to stay. And then there was guys who was coming in there was, selling drugs. And there was guys that had mental health issues, all that. So I went in there with, the carrot and the
right.
stick. Went in there and said, okay, there's a couple things we're going to do. We're going to clean up this building, number one. And here's the carrot. I'm going to put a computer lab in here like I did for Hazelwood and build that program.
Yeah.
Then I put a clinic in there also because these men, the first 2 weeks I was there, went upstairs, guy just passed away, just died in this room.
Mm.
And that's because he didn't have access to health care.
So
I connected with an organization called Healthcare for the Homeless.
Mm-hmm.
They came in. They was coming in 3 days a week.
Wow.
We put a little clinic in there. I cleaned up the place. Started feeding the guys a meal because a lot of these guys, over 70% of those guys work. So
wow.
I start providing them a meal because a lot of these guys they're underemployed.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Now we feed them a breakfast
right.
and we feed them a dinner. You know. So now they don't have to go to work hungry.
Mm-hmm.
And underperform,
mm-hmm.
so they can lose their job,
right.
you know. But being all that, so I became the executive director
mm-hmm.
there. Then they said, okay, let's look at doing some renovations to the facility. Now it's an older facility. The building
yeah.
was built in 1922.
Absolutely old.
First
yeah.
African American
mm-hmm.
YMCA in Pittsburgh is at the Center Avenue
Center
YMCA.
Avenue.
So what I've done, they decided to say, hey, and this was during the time that you know, when the economy took a real bad dive.
Right,
fortunately,
okay.
Pittsburgh didn't get caught up into it because Pittsburgh didn't make a lot of investments
mm-hmm.
like those places down in the South and
right.
Arizona. So the market didn't hit us
right.
too bad. So we invested, the YMCA with their volunteers
mm-hmm.
invested $12 million into this new facility, which is now called the Thelma Lovell
mm-hmm.
YMCA.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Beautiful.
So now, here, I'm going to move from just came out of jail.
Yeah.
Start working for the Y.
Yeah.
Send me over to Center, then over to Hazelwood. Sent me back over to Center to become the executive director. Took a $300,000 deficit down to a $60,000
wow.
deficit. Was able to do it in 2 years. Now they're saying, you're going to run a brand new YMCA.
Mm.
So I had the opportunity
mm-hmm.
to meet with the architects and the designers.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And then I actually helped design a facility.
Oh, that's awesome.
Helped
to
design a facility.
No, I have not. So when we get back, I want to continue the conversation. You're watching The Neil Haley Show, and we'll be back in just a moment.
One of the things we do at BPTV is encourage our producers to film on location. Not only does shooting on location give our producers the opportunity to take advantage of their subject matter, filming in different locations gives each program its own distinct flavor. This also helps anyone who's flipping through the channels avoid confusion when they turn on BPTV. With around 500 programs produced at BPTV each year, the last thing we want people to think is that we're only broadcasting one program. So, you need to come into BPTV to pitch your TV show, but in terms of where you actually end up taping your show, the sky's the limit. We'll be right back.
And Coach, we're back. Yeah. And Coach, when you talk about, you know, specifically the YMCA, yeah. I remember playing in the Black Businessman's League over at the home of YMCA, and Demetrius Gore tearing me up, destroyed me in there. And then later was part of pro wrestling that came to the YMCA when I was a pro wrestler. So that's where you said we were talking about Homewood and stuff. But now you're at the newer YMCA. You're used to taking something that really doesn't look nice and make it look nice. Now you're entrusted to something that looks really nice.
Yes.
That's a challenge because, again, there's nothing but to go down in the facility, not the people. But so how did you handle all that?
Well, first of all, it was no one they didn't provide me a roadmap on how to run a full facility, because you're talking about three different facilities. You're talking about a small program center, which is located in Longwood, in the Hazelwood area, small program center. Then you're talking about a housing facility. No other type of programs other than providing housing for men.
Right.
Now we're talking about a full facility. Mm-hmm. Full facility, swimming pool, gymnasium, multi-purpose room, all state of the art. Now we know we're able to, you know, do more programming.
Where's this located? The one
this is located on 2114 Center Avenue.
Less than 10 minutes from St. Benedict.
Oh, so it's the downtown one?
No. Center Avenue.
Center Avenue.
So if you came down Bedford.
And when was it built? What year?
Actually, it'll be 5 years over. So, 2012.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, 2012. Yeah.
So this April after St. Agnes almost closes, right?
Right.
About that.
Yeah, it's after St. Yes, after St. Agnes so and St. Benedict merge.
It's maybe about four blocks up from Consul Center.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We're now in the PPG.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep. So able to build this 44,000 square foot beautiful facility. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now I'm tasked with programming it, running it.
Yeah.
And the staff that I had over at Center Avenue, they had to continue to do the housing piece there. So I had to hire all new staff.
Mm-hmm.
All new staff with all the roadmap on how to open up this facility. And we did it.
Wow.
We did it. And we just, all expectations, we just blown them away.
Mm-hmm.
We've blown them away.
That's great.
But where it comes back to, you know, what I've learned from my grandmother, you know, having the discipline, you know, hard work. Because I remember she used to, you know, leave out every day, catch the, it was called the 94B morning sack.
Okay.
You know, and she would have her two bags, her two shopping bags. Okay. And she used to go to Squirrel Hill, Highland Park, Staten Heights. And she would clean folks' houses.
Oh,
that's what she did. And she helped raise those families as well. So that helped me to have the, you know, hard work ethic. Then as when I went to Weston House, you know, meeting Dillard and playing football.
Right.
Having that, you know, that team.
Yes.
You know, leadership.
Yes.
You know, working with others.
Right.
Building.
Mm-hmm.
Team building. So all those that I've learned at a very young age, even though I went astray, but also while I got incarcerated, I didn't adapt to the community. I made, in jail, I made the adjustments.
Right.
And made the adjustments because I did not want to become a part of it.
Yes.
Yeah. So I've never been back since I've been home. You know, because I didn't adapt to that environment.
See, the story is for you to be in the position you're at, and then yet your education, you didn't continue unless you continued on when you were working on this. Did you continue to go on to school?
I went back. I went to school. I went did a couple years over at Carlo College.
Oh, great.
Okay.
Yes, but it's just ironic as I was going when I was doing really well at Carlo College, but then that was the time that we were about to open up the facility.
Okay.
So it was just so much time. So the plan is for me to go back to school to pursue my degree in business.
Nice. Okay.
You know, but right now, you know, we're a little over 3,000 members.
Mm.
Wow.
3,000 members. We've actually, there's 17 branches. We have two other campsites, Camp Quantiqui and Camp Deer Valley, and Camp Souls, which is three. But all the branches that does, you know, full facilities, equipment, everything else, you know, we're like the top three.
So it's interesting because I grew up in Hill.
Okay.
And I literally grew up in Elmore Square, which didn't look like it looks today.
No, it doesn't.
So when I see the Thelma Lovett, it's amazing to me the transformation, because right across the street was that first post office I used to go to, which is no longer there.
Right.
So to see the Thelma Lovett Y, and we just had Addison Hall when I grew up.
Right.
But now there's a full service YMCA, where you can come and do all types of different things after school on your off days. It services the community.
Yes.
That is an amazing transformation that you are able to, with your journey, someone's seen that.
So let's talk about the leadership with, it's the boot camp, it's your high school experience, and it's growing up. Before, even though still, even being raised strict, still you got caught up in drugs because of the environment.
Yes.
So, but the boot camp taught you discipline and said, okay, the people that told me the discipline, I don't want to go back there. So that light bulb went on. Mm-hmm. And then now that's how you implement things running it. You know, this has got to be this way. There's not.
Yeah, even when I was running over at Hazelwood School.
Right.
I mean, I'm sorry, Hazelwood YMCA. Like I said, I started off with 10 kids, ended up with 60. What I've learned in boot camp, I started doing in our after-school programs. And they're said,
would that be controversial in some places?
Now it would be. Back then it wasn't. But now,
you know, did you modify?
I just did the push-ups. That's all I did. Okay. You know, if I do 25 push-ups, they had to get down to 25 push-ups.
So you believe discipline's an important thing?
And I had the parents who loved it. I had parents who came in there and said, you know, I got my kids. It was a problem. They come to your after-school program and your summer camp, and they're learning all this stuff from you. They're coming home and doing push-ups, saying, down, up, down, up, down, up, you know, because I was doing it all. But these kids love me, you know, and I see these kids today. And they're like, sometimes they call me Coach Gibson. Yeah. Coach Gibson, because I did coach for Kingsley House as well. But at the same time, I was, you know, I was instilling this discipline in them. Mm-hmm. The parents loved it because they didn't act out. Mm-hmm. And the kids started doing well in school. You know, but now you have to do things a little different. Now,
right.
You know, so now in my position now, you know, I don't get the opportunity to work with the kids.
Right.
I have a vision to do programs, so I hire people to carry that out.
You see here the vision.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? The right vision.
Right. So my vision is actually to work with kids who are not proficient in reading math, which by the time in third grade, if that kid is not proficient in reading math, then that's how they determine how many prisons they'll build. And then that's the age that they'll figure if that kid's ADHD or something like that. And he's not. It's not that he's ADHD.
No,
it's
not
just
at
that
all.
He didn't get the bare fundamentals that he needed to get.
That's right.
Right.
When he was pre-K.
Yep.
Yes.
He didn't know his colors.
Yes.
He didn't know his shapes.
Yes.
He didn't know how to count.
Exactly.
He didn't know his letters.
Exactly.
So he didn't have that. So by the time he's in kindergarten, he's already behind.
Yeah, already behind.
You know what I'm saying? So the goal is for us to get them that they're not behind.
So let me jump into something tonight. You're probably going to, the whole political realm of charter schools and all those different things that we're about to see happen. Probably not the Secretary of Education appointed.
Oh,
she's awful. Boss.
And
you know, you're not going to say that because she could be involved in program funding. But the thing is, she has it right in the one way that our schools need to be focused on growth, meaning that what charter schools do in certain areas and certain that have certain less restrictions than the public school counterparts and the after school programs, the different things, feeding them when they come in the morning, feeding them when they go home at night, those types of things, that's what the Y does. And that's where you see the people that do go to the Y and the success of those kids. That has to be implemented in all public education. There needs to be that type of thing. And I remember, I think I interviewed the person who ran all the YMCAs. I got to go back in my Google search who I interviewed that was a top-notch person. They talked about that's the thing, getting more people to the why. And what the why brings to the table is the biggest challenge you have. The ones that are there, they're the success stories.
Right.
The ones that don't attend are not the success stories.
Well,
because the meaning in certain communities and caught up in stuff.
Well, I'll say this. One thing about the Hill District, the community that I serve, you know, is that there's different organizations in that community, you know. And those different organizations, we look at how we can partner.
Right.
And we don't duplicate the same type of service. Some of the things we do is duplicate, but in most cases you don't. So you have to look at partnerships. The YMCA partnered with different organizations.
Yes.
Now we're not just talking about, well, I just want to target these kids. Now we're targeting the family.
Yes.
And then if we impact the family, we impact the community.
Yeah. Your model can work in public education.
It can work. I believe so. But what we do at the Thelma Lovett YMCA, we partner with the schools in that community. You know, we partner with those principals because those principals want to see outside organizations in their facilities.
Right.
They just want to make sure.
But then it's getting the guardians or parents to make sure that they're on board.
And see that, and that's what we do at the YMCA. We want to engage the parents. That is one of your most challenging.
Yes, it is.
You know, area. You know, is engagement, parent engagement. We can get those parents engaged with the kids, and don't think, well, this is what happens sometimes. You know, these kids, they go to school.
Yeah.
They come to our programs. We do homework with them, right? So some of these parents, they work hard, or, you know, and so by the time they go home, they still have homework. And the parent will sometimes get mad and say, well, why didn't you do the homework with our child? And I will have to say, well, you know, the key word of homework is home, and then there's work, number one. You need to see what your kid is doing.
Yeah.
Then that means that if you understand what your kid is doing, where he's struggling at, then you reach out to the school. Then you call us to make sure we're reinforcing it when we're doing the homework. But you need to be part of that process. It cannot be totally on the YMCA.
So what do you say the education mind of this whole pre-K through third grade, how we can make sure education's fun for kids, but yet they can still progress and know all those things. What do we need to do?
I think here's what I believe. This is what I believe.
Yeah.
I think we got to get the parents to understand that. It starts at home.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, understand what you're saying, but it starts at home.
Well, but see, I even say in the way that we've been caught up in specific things, it's happening in not just low-income families, it's happening in affluent families now.
National problem.
Because of just how busy we're becoming.
Exactly. So now, in the households, you got both parents working.
Yep.
You know, I have a 9-year-old and a 4-year-old. Right. You know, and my wife, she works full-time as well.
Right, it's a challenge.
You know, it's a challenge, but we have to work together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, so in the mornings, I drop off, you know, my one child daycare, you know, she walks down my oldest son.
Right.
She takes him to the school bus.
Right. Exactly.
You know, and then she picks him up, and then when we come home, she comes home.
But
she
it's such a challenging and draining.
It is.
We're gonna stop giving excuses to the parents.
But here I'm gonna go in.
Go ahead. This perspective. Go ahead.
I think that the teachers that are trained need to become better at understanding the home life. One of the big things I pushed is home visits. For teachers to have to go in and visit the homes and develop that relationship, or at least the principals. Schools that have done that have had great success in that area. We need a community to work together, and that the teachers should not think that they're authoritarian in a way that they don't need the extra help from the parents. It's a team atmosphere. But I think we're suffering in so many ways, and we're suffering in public education, even though it's fake. A lot of these numbers are fake. A lot of these things are happening. We're watering down our education system everywhere, and who's suffering the most are the ones with less.
I just say to that, though, I think we need to raise up the families, because I agree that the teachers can go in, but there is a personal responsibility for parents, which for me, I think they've just kind of slid it over to the schools, you know, making holding the teachers more accountable, and they're just sort of easing off that.
But we have to look at a 16-year cycle of trying to figure out education. Again, both teachers, we're going to start our argument.
Well, no.
And our debate is, we have about a minute left.
Yeah, we do.
So, best place we can find information on you. But this is a debate we need to continue to have this conversation with, because the truth is, I'm more used to be the teacher, and now I'm the entrepreneur, and I have a tutoring business still, but I'm more focused on the entrepreneur, and I'm seeing with my 5 kids that ultimately, 2 working parents, if they're getting home at 6 each, 7 o'clock at night, we have to figure out that homework is a value to progress them, to preparing them for life. Not homework is busy work. And so also having the kids do their homework at school is an absolute waste of time. My brightest child that gets all her work home, I have nothing, Dad. That's a mistake, Pine Richland. So we have to have a happy medium in all those things. So best place we can find info on you, where can we go?
Well, 2114 Center Avenue, YMCA, 15219, in the history of the Hill District, you know, the great place.
Yeah.
And the number is 412-315-0990. We do it all at the Thelma Lovett YMCA, and I'm proud to be a part of what we've been able to do in the Hill District.
Well, we love you sharing your story. Great story.
And speaking of the Hill, I interviewed Michael T. Williams from Francis that was in Bubba. Then I interviewed him on yesterday. You're watching the Neil Haley Show. We'll see you next week. Take care, guys.